What will I discuss? First of all, I will look at the general developments. And this is, let's say, I want to discuss the status and the trends. So where are we now? And where are we possibly going to? So we have general developments, and general developments, I mean not political developments in the world. We will not discuss Putin against Obama, but more in the geometrics field. Then I will have a look at dense image matching, especially related to oblique imagery. Furthermore, on airborne lidar, we see an interesting development going on, which uses multispectral airborne lidar, a technology which has been presented recently by Optec. Radar, especially here in, I say here, but we are still in North America, but when we go 1,000 kilometers south, we do have tropical rainforest, and there it is important to have radar as a good mapping technology. And at the end, I will also to go indoors with you with how we can map in create point clouds from robots which are moving through a scene. But first, I want to point out, discuss with you the what is a point cloud? There are many different discussions, definitions are possible. Point clouds consist of millions and millions, even billions of points, but somehow these points are copies from each other. That means that there are a kind of nucleus. They do have an XY component, and to this component, and the component of the position in two-dimensional space, a number of additional information is assigned. Of course, where we are used to when we talk about point clouds is the height, or when we are at sea, at the depth of the location. So this could be considered as a Z component, although we usually refer it to a geoid or to an ellipsoid. We can add colors to the XY components, usually of, let's say, in the these colors are stemming from imagery. We have red, green, blue, but it can of course also be the near infrared part. Other attribute values, we can add some mega metadata to the to each point, whether it is measured or interpolated or just inserted in some by human being. And the intensity of the return signal is an important attribute. And today, of course, we do have full waveform digitization, in which we have per location many different types of intensity returns. And very important, we all know that, but when you are talking to laymen, they think we are ready when we do have these parameters, but the quality indicator is the most important indicator, because that tells me for what type of application I can use my data. Developments. We do have the number of sensors, the types of sensors from which we can create point clouds, they are increasing. And also within the sensors, we see divergence, that some of the sensors are going in this direction or in that direction. Another problem, and this is a problem we study a lot at Delft University of Technology, that is how to store the data in databases so that we can retrieve in a convenient way, and not that it takes days or weeks before we got the information to get quick retrieval of the information. Another one is the applications, and the applications are steadily growing. And of course, anybody can say today that our applications are growing and growing. That's a truth. But here I've listed, here in the core, I have the point cloud, the products we can derive from the point clouds, and the diverse types of applications. Yes, forest inventory, it started with LiDAR especially, it started for forest applications. But we see also in mining, and also in civil engineering, volume calculation, we see 3D modeling of plants, but also 3D modeling of cities, and so on. Very diverse applications. So that is another development we see. And then we do have, when we look at the software, now that's interesting, of course, because we are here with Rakus here and with Photomod. When we see it, when we look at the different type of software, and there is a lot of software on the market which can process point clouds. I think one of the companies, for example, Terra Solid, and I mention it because I think they are very good products. But when you look at the software, then we see some of the software is focused on point cloud creation. And that means actually that when I do have overlapping images, I can apply stereo matching technologies to create X, Y, and Z points. Other focus on georeferencing. The data storage is, of course, important. We talked already about visualization and editing for a lot of town planners, for people who are using 3D models, the visualization is important. So we do have a complex, when we look at the software, the software is coming from diverse backgrounds. Okay, then dense image matching. Dense image matching started, let's say, about to become a popular in photogrammetry around 2010. And what does digital image matching mean? We do have two overlapping images, and for each pixel, I find the corresponding pixel in the other image, or when I can also use three or four images. So, and basically, dense image matching focuses on that on very dense, of course, but that I can get for each pixel in my image, I can get a height information. For example, when I do have a GSD of 10 centimeters, when I do have when I look at the square meter, I can have 100 height points created with dense image matching. And when we look at why has this become possible, this dense image matching, I mean, I told you in 1988, I wrote this paper on image matching, and at that time I never could envision that we could compute so fast for each pixel a height value. But it has to do with a number of developments. One has to do with the graphical processing units in the computers that can be used for carrying out computation. But also, when I discuss some of the developments in our field, I mean, in 1988, we had the dream that you put an image in the computer, and then after some time, you had a topographic map rolling out of the system automatically. That was the dream, but we were young, so we don't have the dream anymore, but we are still young. I will prove that. The progress actually is when you look at what we can do with computer vision technology with our images, focus especially on creating point clouds. And in 2008, Jirs Müller developed the same global matching algorithm. And that was during a PhD research. He never patented this algorithm, so it is free to use for everybody. We have cheap computer power, cheap digital cameras. We saw consumer cameras which can be used. And we have also, from computer vision, we have to rely for a lot of things on computer vision, open source packages, they become available. Okay, the oblique images. We do have dense image matching, and dense image matching, the latest research and application is on applying dense image matching for oblique images. Okay, this is an example of such an oblique image. This is actually what is called the Maltese cross concept, as already developed before the Second World War by Fairchild, but it has been picked up again 10 years back by pictometry, and actually the system of pictometry, in contrast to the A3 edge, which has a completely different way of creating oblique images, but this is one of the concepts of creating 3D of oblique images. This is a point cloud, a very dense point cloud, created from oblique images. And this is done by the group of Remondino from Italy. And we see here, there's a detail from the previous point cloud, and we see how many points we can create, how dense the point cloud is. But are we there? No, we are not yet there. We have the oblique images, but we do have a number of problems to solve to get reliable, accurate information. And one of them is that in oblique images, we do have large variations in scale. Because an oblique image, when you are close to the airplane, you have the objects are bigger than when you are far away from the airplane. We have also illumination changes, and there's a lot of shadows are present because of the buildings. And because of the buildings and other objects, we have many occlusions. And this sketch shows how it is these occlusions are created. It was already discussed during the discussion, which we should continue later on, that there are still a lot of open questions, and also these open questions are also formulated by Remondino. And one of them is when to use, for what type of applications do we want for the oblique images? Do we know exactly what are the strengths and the weaknesses of oblique images? There's a technology, looks great, initial results are promising, but then we arrive at the operationalization of the technology. And then the flight path, what is the acquisition pattern for metric mapping, when we want to create maps. And then illumination and scale changes, one of these challenges we discussed here. And which processing software is reliable and efficient. And it's something we have to find out. And also, when we apply the software, we cannot only suffice with saying, okay, this is the accuracy in millimeter or centimeter or decimeter, but there are other aspects, for example, the points missing? And do we have gaps in our digital elevation model? So, and also on this aspect, research is carried out. Then I arrive at LIDAR, and also LIDAR, and it's nice. Of course, that's a nice thing about technology, that we have developments also stemming from demands from customers. We see here a number of applications of the use. And what we see is that when I started in 97, with researching airborne lidar for applications in the Netherlands for creating a very dense digital elevation model for the entire Netherlands, then we see that the number of pulses which can be emitted by the system is now up to 1 million per second. So that is not only that we can create very dense digital elevation models, but also that we create a lot of data. And then we arrive at the problem how to store all these data. Multiple pulses in air is another aspect. Full waveform digitization. Here an example of the Regal system of waveform digitization. And that in this way, especially when we talk about forest areas and vegetation, that we can distinguish a different type of vegetation. When we look at the trends, then we see multispectral LiDAR. Photon LiDAR is also discussed, especially from the scientific field. Photon LiDAR means actually that we only need a few photons to get an a height, the point cloud. So that means instead of that we do have one pulse, we can separate one pulse in, for example, 100 smaller pulses and create a denser digital elevation model. And of course, we do have unmanned airborne system, also many times already mentioned, although most of you use the word drone or UAV. I think the proper name is Unmanned Airborne System, UAS. It is a system, it is not a vehicle, but it is a system because it is equipped with additional sensors, with GPS, with ENS, with cameras, and so on. So that's why it is a system and not a vehicle. And it's also not a drone, because drone is too much associated with the military use. And so we should never use this term, especially when we are close to the US. And LiDAR, the sensors are becoming smaller and smaller so that we can mount them. Here's an example which was demonstrated last year in December in Amsterdam during a conference that we can mount it on just an onocopter. I will have a look at multispectral LiDAR. Multispectral LiDAR, this is an OPTEC also, in December 2014, they presented a system which is able to emit in three different bands. Here we see the bands. These are very narrow bands, actually. One in the green, which is today used for bathymetric purposes, because green can pass water and reflects on the bottom of the lake of the sea. And then we do have two near-infrared bands, which are used for land applications. And they are mixed, they are merged in one system. And of course, the manufacturer has some applications in mind. Points, of course, will this become true or will it become other application? For example, where I was thinking of when I first heard about this these bands used, how can we use it in Holland to map the dunes area and the sea area simultaneously? Would that be possible? And of course, then you have some the problems of is the water clear enough and so on. When we look now at the beams themselves, what we would like to have is that the pulses they hit the same place on Earth, the same point on Earth. But at this very moment, there are they hit different points because the three beams used, they do not pass the exact same part. So they do not refer to the same terrain point. Nevertheless, when we transfer the point cloud, to a raster image, yeah, which is possible, then we can, in the raster, we can combine by interpolation, we can combine the information. But there's something still where multispectral LiDAR needs to be improved, that we, all the returns that they refer to the same point on Earth. We are not that far from South America. We are not that far from the tropical rainforest. When I look here at the temperature, sometimes I think of this tropical rainforest here, the tropical temperature. In Brazil is well known, actually, it's, I think this the first mapping application, mapping of the tropical zones in Brazil was done in the early 70s with radar. And that continues, but of course the technology is improving. And today, the Bradasa, which is an organization, a company in Brazil, operates the system which has two radar, which emits two radar bands, the X and the P band. And these have been used recently, 2008, 2010, to create digital terrain models, digital surface models, auto images, and also maps, scale 1 to 50,000. So it adds definitely to mapping the world, such a system, by using X and the P band. And the P band is 75 centimeters, and the X band is as a wavelength of 3 centimeters. And the advantage of when you look at the 3 centimeter band, and there's an image in a 3 centimeter band, the same area is covered by the 75 centimeter band, that it can pass the foliage of the trees. Yeah, and that is because of the wavelengths. And the longer the electromagnetic light is affected by the size of the objects it meets. So that means that the visible light is distorted by very small particles in the air. The longer the wavelength, the less it is disturbed. And 75 centimeters is larger than the leaves on the trees, so we can see the on the terrain. And that brings interesting applications. The P band when it is especially suited for mapping forest areas, because in order to get signal back, use has to be made of the double bounce effect. So that means that this the radar pulse comes in, reflects on the ground, supposing this is the law of Snell, and then reflects again on trees and is reflected back in the direction of the sensor. And that means that we can create from this not only the digital surface model, so that means the reflections on top of the trees from the X band. This creates a digital surface model, but we can also a digital terrain model, meaning terrain here that is really the bare, that is the ground underneath the trees. So we can compute from that the vegetation height. And the vegetation height, that's for forestry important because it gives an idea about what can I expect over 5 years on production. But it is, of course, also important to determine the biomass, which is important for the CO2 discussion. So by using the vegetation height maps combined with ground truth, we can compute the carbon stocks available. Also, this is not my own work. This is coming from Sabati and Lubak, who are from the Bradasar. Okay, how much?
Сколько у меня еще времени осталось? несколько минут.
Above the tropical rainforest, but now I want to, in a couple of minutes, I want to give you a tour to the indoor tours. And that's actually that we see the problem. Let me go to this slide over here. This is a 3D mapping trolley which was introduced this year at Intergeo. And what we see at the system is that it contains laser scanners and cameras, but it does not contain a GPS because it has been developed for indoor applications. And indoor, we can, the GPS signals, as we all know, are blocked. So our positioning is a problem. So how to do that? Okay, there are indoor mapping and indoor positioning technologies have been developed, one of them on Wi-Fi combined with fingerprinting. But can it be done independently of really getting position data? And it is possible with using software, the positioning of the robot or the system can be determined and then combined with the sensor data and prior knowledge. And these guesses, and then again the computer power comes in. In 1988, we didn't have this computer power today. We do have this type of computer power that by iteration we can improve our positioning and our orientation in space. And these algorithms are based on the iterative closest point algorithm. And also these are coming actually from robotics, from computer vision, to move robots through space. And what is used is landmarks, and we have to distinguish, as we do also with feature-based matching, we have features distinct from the surrounding. So a number of techniques we use also in photogrammetry are used here also. And the positioning or orientation sensors, which can be used, are automators or inertial navigation systems, and also lasers, which determine distances to objects. And that's also important for avoidance of obstacles. So, and this is one of the 3D models created in Germany. Yeah, and this has been created by this trolley. These are it has been developed as research at the Munich University of Technology. And then, and that's why I put the founders of the firm here. These young guys did their research and they founded their own company to bring the system on the market, and I think at this moment already 10 have been sold. So this is one of the creation of 3D models, point clouds. We do have the images which can be superimposed on the images on the point clouds.